It's been a long time coming, but I know a change gon' come. Oh, yes it will.
All right, Sheena Simmons, it's been 206 days now and counting for LaMelo. Let's see the hands who think it's going to take a year for us to find out what happened to a 3.5-month-old in the middle of an I-10 in Biloxi after approximately 34 shots rang out. What was that, bro?
My hand is up.
Oh, you think it's going to be? Do you?
If not longer.
Why is that, you think? Why do you think they're not releasing any information on this?
I think that they are taking full advantage of a couple things, not the least of which what might be a backlog at whatever lab. But also, doing ballistics investigation in such a way that they are requiring themselves to take as much possible time as they can. Hmm.
Yeah. What, for what reason you think that?
To trace the bullets.
Well, I think they're expecting for things to go away, to be quite frank, folks. I've heard as much. I've been asked on several occasions, Rip, come on, you know we're going to do a good job. You know, and I must tell you, ladies and gentlemen, I do have confidence in the Biloxi PD. I do. However,
according to them, they're done with their job.
Well, yeah. However, you know, my countdown is primarily because there seems to be a lack of consideration for we who are the public who paid for those dash cams and body cams. You know, it'd be a different story if we got an investigation and there's some questions as to who done it or didn't do it. This is law enforcement here, bro. This is not, the assailant is dead. In the double murder over in Baton Rouge.
Well, yeah, but I mean, the assailant that killed LaMelo Parker.
Well, he had to be one.
I guess we can't even call him an assailant. Well,
he had to be there. In other words, it's not a search for anybody. There's no, you know, and so this is just really quite. I think this is the arrogance, and I'm going to say this to my law enforcement friends. Because it's only been recently that you did this. It really was, ladies and gentlemen. Only recently, because of cell phones and so forth, that you began to have this kind of not release of information. I mean, there's a reason why we have the Freedom of Information Act, right? There's a good reason for that. But in recent years, actually, with the advent of many of you recording what happened, and thanks to the to a passerby, we had a recording of what happened to LaMelo. But even when you didn't have this, there was at least more information provided, even if it was erroneous. So we'll let you know. I want to go quickly here to the, they've got the closing arguments to the Arbery trial. By the way, I call it Arbery trial primarily because it's always the dead guy on trial. I want to go ahead and bring that up.
Natural and necessary consequences of an act. Deadly force is the last resort. Never point a gun at someone you do not intend to shoot. So when you start pointing a shotgun directly at somebody, what's your intention? The natural and necessary consequence of the act. You're going to kill this person. You're pointing it at them. The defendant's not going to be presumed to have acted with criminal intent, but you may find intention or the absence of intention upon consideration of their words, their conduct, what did they do out there, their demeanor, their motive, and other circumstances. So when you look at each defendant separately, because that's what you're going to do, you're going to get three separate verdict forms. When you look at Mr. Bryan, what were his words? What was his conduct? What's his motive?
Let me just tell you, this Linda Donikoski is an incredible prosecutor. She really prosecuted this case very well.
Agreed.
Go ahead and record the rest of this. Much better than, as far as I'm concerned, what happened in Kenosha. So it is over. And the verdict is in. And I can tell you, I got it wrong. I thought for sure it'd be a hung jury. But I did get right the fact that there was not going to be any tearing up Kenosha. After all, this was a civilian situation. It did not involve law enforcement. But it was, it did involve privilege in a very big way.
If his conduct was privileged as to Rosenbaum, it's privileged as to Mr. McGinnis. Kyle Rittenhouse's conduct on August 25th was privileged based upon the actions of Mr. Rosenbaum and others. Putting Kyle Rittenhouse down for something he was privileged to do will serve no legitimate purpose.
So, let me just say this right off the bat. The jury got it wrong. And all due respects to many who suggest that the jury has spoken and we will abide by it, I want to bring you to what just recently happened. Well, even in the Malcolm X assassination, where two men were exonerated. How many people who have been on death row or have been accused falsely and convicted by juries have ultimately been let go thanks to the Innocent Project, bro? Are you in the show with me today? Are we here? I said.
I'm sorry, I was screening.
Well, what you do is you stop screening and then you start listening. Thank you very much. So how many people in the Innocent Project? How many people have been freed as a result of the efforts of the Innocent Project?
365
people. A jury decided were guilty, who ultimately had to decide. Mm-hmm.
Around 20 were on death row.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, you know, someone had brought up jury nullification, and I don't doubt that's what happened here in Kenosha. I don't accept their verdict at all. Not even close. I don't, primarily because juries, as of late, have gotten it very, very wrong, and they got this wrong. Let me just tell you, if in fact Rittenhouse was afraid, trust me, the other people around him were deathly afraid. That's why they scattered. He was the one with the long rifle. He was the one suspected of having intentions to do something wrong, venturing into a place that police told him not to, carrying the weapon parallel to the ground, running with it, no less. Not strapped on his shoulder. He was the one who aimed at Rosenbaum, and Rosenbaum, even though he was aimed at, felt it was necessary to stop. And you want to know what was going through his mind? It was that right there. Then upon watching this man be shot down, Rosenbaum, others realized this guy just shot someone. We got to stop this guy. We got to stop this guy. Police, are you aware? And this is why I really resent what happened with. Hang on, Josh. We're going to get you. Here's why I resent what happened with the prosecutor. He did not play the 911 calls coming from the protesters about Rittenhouse. He should have done that. He should have done it. Because the protesters that the judge called rioters and so forth indicated that these rioters, these were not victims. Well, who do you think was calling? 911. You can't just vilify everyone who was in the street that night as being a rioter, an arsonist, an Antifa, whatever you want to call it.
Regardless their record.
This is very, very serious, and we have just let a guilty man loose. And let me just tell you something about Rittenhouse. You're going to hear from him again. This kid is going to have some mental problems, not because necessarily of this. This made it worse. He had it before then. His mother took him to a riot. His mother took him to a riot. His daddy allowed him to go with an AR. Did we lose Josh? Yes? No?
He had a question about the guy who kicked Rittenhouse. Yeah. I was answering out there.
Actually, that guy should have been subpoenaed as well.
He demanded immunity before he would testify. They didn't give it to him.
And they should have. They should have. He was trying to stop a killer who he just saw kill someone. So his task was to stop this guy from running, kind of like what you would do with Jack Rubin or the man who shot Bobby Kennedy, just trying to get out now, Sirhan Sirhan. You don't know. Friendly, we know he just shot someone and he's not a cop. He just shot someone. Okay. Let me just tell you what all of them were thinking. What they were thinking was how to stop Rittenhouse from shooting someone else. And he did. Shot Huber. Shot Coscruz. Gage. All shot. We're going to hear from him again, bro. Trust me on this. Proud Boy's going to take him in as a poster child. You know, you'll hear him doing something else, overreact. The losers do that, you see. The men who buy their bravado at the barrel of a gun just can't wait to brag on it. Really and truthfully.
He's being celebritized. He was being celebritized the whole time.
Well, I understand that. The Dog Network had cameras on him?
Yeah. Tucky has a documentary in production on him. And actually, it was that documentary crew that captured his response to that verdict.
Really?
Here he is. Hold on, I gotta take my headphones off.
The jury reached the correct verdict. Self-defense is not illegal. And I believe they came to the correct verdict, and I'm glad that everything went well. And it's been a rough journey, but we made it through it.
He knew he was guilty, which is why he collapsed. The men who were defending themselves were the men who were out there, two of which are dead. They did not come there with the intent to kill someone. They didn't have their weapon out, slung across their shoulder. Nope. So, yeah, we'll talk about it. Get your reaction. What does it say to you? There were some protests out. Keep in mind, everyone involved in this were quote-unquote Caucasian. This needs to dispel the myth that civil rights, civil liberties, and the miscarriage of justice is only for African Americans. There's no doubt about the fact that it is certainly tougher against African Americans. The evidence shows that. Stats show that. But these guys were out there protesting on behalf of Jason Blake, shot in the back 7 times. He's paralyzed.
Jacob
Blake, I'm sorry. And this sends a real strong message, I think, to some quote unquote white boys in quotes who would do what Schwerner did, and Goodman, you know, those individuals who were lynched along with Cheney, the three civil rights workers. This is message sending. It's what this is all about. You could not have seen a worse or a better example of a kangaroo court, as far as I'm concerned, with the kangaroo sitting there in the robe. He did have that look, didn't he? Didn't he look like a big kangaroo?
Wow.
So yeah, we'll get your comments on it. It is not done. It is not over. I can tell you that right now. It will come back. This now 18 year older.
You don't think Kyle gonna disappear?
No,
I mean willingly.
No, he can't. He can't purposefully. Disappear. No, he can't disappear. He's swept up now, and he's going to feel invincible. Mm. You're sort of like that tiger who tastes his blood. Somewhere down the line, he's going to want to do it again. And I think you hadn't heard from Zimmerman the same. I'm not wishing anything on him. I'm not wishing anything for him either, except that he gets what's coming to him. How about that? Don't you wish that for anyone? Karma is a witch. Just saying. So, yeah, if you want to call in and say, okay, how you think the jury did the right thing, came to the right decision, fine. I could tell you I do feel the prosecutors, unlike what we're seeing now in Georgia, prosecutors did bungle the case. Even with that, though, there's no way in the world the jury should not have found Rittenhouse not guilty on all counts. I just, you know, bro. I mean, the idea that he would fire an AR-15 at an individual when you've got another man standing behind him, that's endangerment. But for the defense attorney to say that it was privileged. All right, it's Monday. We get caught up in all the stuff that happened over the weekend. I got another question here I want to put out there for you folks in Mississippi. Just a simple question, and there are those who are watching this question very closely. Now you're able to put your driver's license and your vaccination on your telephone. Simple question, would you? Let's go ahead and put it up. Put it on our chat room, too. Actually, law enforcement, the Highway Patrol, is looking at this. If you would, why not? Would you put your vaccination and your license on your cell phone? And you can do this, too. I think there's a site you can go to do it. We might give it out here in a little bit. Just a simple question. Which brings me to this. Today's the last day for you federal employees to have your vaccination. Are you fired? How you feel about that? I'll tell you how I feel about that. Here's my prediction. There is going to be a serious surge in Mississippi very soon. We've seen this before, you guys. Come on. As the winter gets closer, right? It starts there in the Midwest, and you can see the states there that where it's increasing, meaning the infections are increasing. Started in Maine, and now, of course, Maine was cold. As it gets cold, we get closer, and you know how that works. Stay inside more. Well, in Mississippi, a very few percentage of us are vaccinated. Comparatively speaking, significant number of us are not. There will be a surge in Mississippi. That's my prediction. Between now and Christmas, January, there will be a surge, the likes of which we've seen before. The only thing that's going to make it better is that there's enough of us who are vaccinated. But look, if you're not vaccinated, you get ready for this now. You're going to go to grandma's house for Turkey Day, Thanksgiving. By the way, I might want to throw this out to you, too. People who are coming to your house, would you require that they be vaccinated? No, really. Children, adults. I understand you can get a booster. Will you ask? I don't know. But today's the last day. How do I feel about it? I feel like I'm sick and tired of COVID. I'm not sick and tired of vax and no vax. COVID, how do you get rid of it? You stop spreading it. I don't need to guess. You use whatever means necessary to stop it from spreading. If you do not, then there's going to be other variants. Right now, you got the folks who's idiots in Holland now, jumping up and down. Holland, I think, Denmark? Finland, one of them. Norway is now talking about having mandates for vax for all of the population. Just check New Zealand. New Zealand will tell you exactly how to deal with this. They are not having these problems because they stopped the spread. This is not about a rights thing. You have a right to be without a vax. I got a right not to get your COVID. Now, how are you going to stop me from doing that? You sneeze, I die. Come on. Come on, let's get past this. We gotta get past this. I'm just sick of it. And I'm just sick of individuals who will just automatically assume that it won't get worse. Look, I'm an optimist. It's just how viruses work. Okay, you're still getting boosters from measles. The inoculation happens every year. Baby is born. By the way, did you know measles now? There's a bigger outbreak since COVID with measles because kids are not, we're not being vaccinated. I mean, this is how this works. Come on. Just, I mean, don't argue with me about it.
But I mean, would you not say that folks really need to stop expecting a silver bullet here? I mean, this is not how that works.
Well, first we had to wear masks from nowhere, man. Come on. Blame COVID. Your grandmother dead, blame COVID. Then now you got this idiot there down at DeSantis down in Florida. You know, now he's saying that there's a natural immunity, and maybe so. Okay. Maybe there's a natural immunity. You had it, therefore you don't have to have the vaccination. Can that be an exemption for that? Well, I think that could be an exemption if and only if you're able to be tested. I personally feel they still need to be tested, even though you have the vaccine. Folks, look, the way we get rid of diseases like this is a test. If you got lice, I've told you this before, right? And lice is not an aerosol. You don't spread it in the air. You get lice. Right? There are some who don't get lice. I don't get lice. Thank God for kinky hair. You know? But I've been in school. When I first went integration, they had the school, the classes, some of the classes had to let out for lice. I didn't know what that was. Then I saw one in a white boy's hair. I used to think, boy, he has good hair. But he got lice. Can't be that good. I'm just saying, bro. Look at this hair. His hair lays down. He got lice. You ever seen lice? They're horrible looking. It's not something you want. His head was matted. Never washed his hair. Well, that needs to say, the only way you could stop it was a check. Right? And that's what the school, that's what this, I'd hate to bend that.
They're like people fleas.
Immersed in people fleas. And they do bite, I hear. I've never been bitten by one. Look, the long and short of it, ladies and gentlemen, I'm just at a point whereby we need to stop being silly for the sake of someone convincing you it's about your rights. You want to stop this from spreading, then what you've got to do is everything you can do. You can wear your mask. You can have a vaccine. All of this. But there has to be some desire, some attempt for you to keep from giving it to me, even if you don't think you'll get it. You can stay away. Really and truthfully, don't go to dinner. Say, well, I'm not vaccinated, and I don't want to run the risk of giving it to y'all. They have a right not to get it from you, don't you think? Don't you think? You want to argue with me? Go ahead. But it's just going to show me just how truly selfish you are. It's just going to show me that. Because I don't know what else to say. Look, the average family now knows at least 2 to 3 people who have died from COVID. You don't have to argue. You don't have to look at the statistics up there in Jackson. You don't have to go. You don't have to go to Baptist Hospital. You know people who have had it. You know people who have had a rough go of it. Now you just got to ask yourself, well, okay, I may not have a rough go, but you might be giving it to someone else. So I always have my bandana here, folks. All right. So you're gonna put your license and all on your phone?
Hell no.
Why?
Why?
Exactly. Don't you trust?
Exactly. Why?
Don't you trust?
Why
technology?
Give me a hard copy if I got to make it digital? The state has it. CDC's got my vax record, hopefully.
Well, how many times you've lost
Mr.
your license?
Mr. Pittman, they got my record. Okay, cool.
You lost your license and all. I mean, come on.
Okay, then I'll go online and order a new
what
one.
What about your vaccination? You lose that, too.
I lost that last week, as a matter of fact.
Wish you had it on your phone now, don't you?
I was about to go to New Orleans, too. I was like, oh, damn. Couldn't go.
All right, folks. Okay, we got to deal with all of it. That's a whole lot more. I'm going to prove to you before the show is over that
I found it. Don't come for me. I found it.
That we're still in the bygone era. The feudal system is alive and well in Mississippi. Conservatives, from Dictator Reeves to Philip Gunn to Delbert Hostman to every other conservative that you know about, is trying to maintain a feudal system, basically the system of enslavement, the very rich, very poor. And this is not some status warfare thing. I've got proof here. I've got proof that you can see the comparisons here. And especially if you are a Caucasian blue-collar worker, you know, not one of the good old boys, but would like to be, thinking that somehow or another you can work your way up to that, you know you can't. You are not going to get in the club. You're just not. I mean, The only way you get in the club is pay your way in. And they're not going to pay you enough for you to pay your way in. And everything that's set up right now is set up so that it protects those who have from those who have not. You understand what I'm saying? I know it very well. I've been a have-not for a long time, and I've fought a good fight. And I'm still fighting as a small business. But I'm telling you, if you're a small Caucasian-owned business, you are in the same shape as Rip Daniels. Because they are those who are trying to maintain the good old boy system, the monopoly system. That is the conservative system. And you will say you're conservative only in as much as you'll be accepted by them in hopes that maybe you can be a vendor or that you won't get fired. I am not your problem. Rip Daniels, any other small business on some black guy running down the street, we are not your problem. Your problem is sitting right there in the state house. I'm going to prove that. Dictator Reeves, Philip Gunn, all of them talking about cutting personal taxes, raising sales tax, and of course, limiting your access to medical marijuana or any other medicine. The zoning out of businesses and jobs, and then of course, maintaining the status quo. What is the status quo? Well, they set the status and you are the quo, right? You are the quota, status quo. See, we'll let a few of you in, but you got to work for a major company, a power company, insurance company, a major bank, and then we'll let you ease in. But then you've got to follow what we tell you to follow. We'll give you some jobs. We'll give you some contracts. Some of you know exactly what I'm talking about. And I'm going to take this veil off. Now, I've been on enough boards and commissions to be able to know this quite well, folks. And I'm going to prove it to you. In hopes of one hope, my hope is but one, and that's this. My hope is that many of you who are aspiring small businesses will understand that and start forming cooperatives. You got me? A good example of that would be what has happened now with French's Drugs, Beach Pharmacy, and some others. Just small drugstores, mom-and-pop drugstores, been around forever. They formed their own little cooperative, right, to sustain themselves against the big CVSs and the Walgreens. And by the way, the Walgreens and the CVSs, you might think that they're national companies and so certainly don't have any roots here in Mississippi. And you're sort of kind of right, but you realize they have enough lawyers here in Mississippi and lobbyists to be able to go to the legislature and say what corner they want to have their drugstore on. But you know that you do understand that where of course, it's CVS and Walgreens has nothing to do with it, one can argue. But you do realize that where Walgreens is right now on Cowan Road, there was once what there? A gas station.
A gas station?
Gas station, Butler's gas station, African American managed and owned but gas station.
The corner of Pass and Cowan?
Pass and Cowan.
Wow.
Didn't know that, did you?
That's always been prime real estate.
Prime real estate, and then of course it became a McDonald's. Well, how does that just happen? Well, of course it's landowners and so forth, folks. There's no doubt about that, but there's zoning included in this.
Meaning that the city can change what that land can be used for?
Absolutely. And how do they do that? Well, they go before the commission and they have their lobbying, and a mayor feels this, a city councilman feels that, and voila, there you have it. Now, look, I'm not
fighting. Whoa, one question on that. Yeah. Do they have to alert the public before they do that?
Yeah, the public's always on notice whenever there's a commission meeting.
But are they required?
Yeah, they're required.
Okay.
Yeah, the sunlight laws require that.
Gotcha.
However, they put it in an obscure place. I mean, it's not like they go out and put it on the radio. I don't do that. But I'm going to prove to you, ladies and gentlemen, that the conservative good old boy system, the system that existed when Jeff Davis, by the way, did you know that many of those big plantation owners were not from Mississippi? Of course, you would expect that. Mississippi was a young state. But many of them were from the east, southeast, in and around South Carolina, North Carolina, they knew something about enslavement. And then, of course, Kentucky, that's where Jeff Davis was from. They came here, bought huge tracts of land. But it wasn't just the large landowners that owned the most of those enslaved. Now, this is not an enslavement discussion, but it is a discussion of conservatives and how they want to maintain this system. To keep the very poor, and very uneducated, and strangely enough, very unhealthy, or at the very least, their health depends on what they say, which is why you don't have Medicaid expansion. Hang on, I'm going to go to the phones. It's going to be a rile and tumble day on this Monday. We'll be back.
Get the info. Get the info.
Stay informed. It's a new day with Rip Daniels, the number one talk show in South Mississippi on Jay-Z 94.5.
Just gonna stand there and watch me burn. Well, that's all right. Just gonna stand there and hear me cry. Well, that's alright, because I love the way you lie. I love the way you lie.
Justify their actions by claiming citizen's arrest. I'm gonna remind you once again, evidence from the witness stand, they never, ever said on February 23rd, 2020, that they were doing a citizen's arrest or trying to arrest him. It was all, we wanted to stop, we wanted to question him about what he was doing, because he must have committed a crime that day, and we were gonna hold him so the police could go back and figure out what crime it was that he must have committed as he was running down the street. Citizen's arrest.
Linda Donikoski there, folks, for the prosecution in the Arbery trial going on right now. This is the closing arguments. The prosecutor will do their closing, and then the defense is given theirs. I don't know whether all three of the representatives of each of the defendants will have a closing or not. This could go on for a while. It might take 2 days here, ladies and gentlemen, but so far so good. She is laying this out. It was not self-defense. It was a hunt, to say the least. It was not a citizen's arrest. They never said that. And Arbery said nothing, did nothing, outside of trying to keep himself from being shot with a pump shotgun. Those are the facts. I want to go to Miss Faye here. Good morning, Miss Faye. Thank you for being patient.
Good morning. How are y'all doing this morning?
I'm doing groovy. How are you?
I'm doing very well this morning. I was disappointed with the verdict about that boy getting off on all counts. And I'm concerned about the Arbery trial because I think that when you, a child carries a RA-15 or whatever it is, and he's in the crowd, and you don't think that something is wrong with that scene, something's wrong with you. And I feel like they fixed it so where the judge was in on it. And they came with that conclusion, not guilty on everything. That was not a trial, not a true trial, because the young man that got killed didn't get justice,
yeah,
nor anyone else that he injured. And as far as Arbery is concerned, I hope that all three of them get justice. Will stay in prison as long as they live, never get the break of day, don't get a chance to have a retrial or whatever it is, because it's this. You reap what you sow. Mm. What goes around comes around, and it will come around to you. And I feel like these old laws, especially in Georgia, where they can say a citizen is free to citizens arrest, that was formed in 18 something.
Yeah, they've actually they actually rescinded that law. You're right. After this happened, so you're absolutely right.
And I'm telling you, and I just wonder, I'm asking you, Rip, how many old laws do we have in Mississippi that they might want to be trying to revive?
I'll thank you for calling. I will We'll search that. Old laws, maybe laws of self-defense. I don't know. But you're right about that. This whole idea of citizen's arrest. I do know that you still can have a citizen's arrest. Actually, that's what happens when you literally go out and sign an affidavit. You know, of course, the officers will act upon the affidavit. Let's say something happens to you, right? And you file charges. Now, that's not the same as holding someone right there, by no means. However, if the officers do not see the actual infraction, theoretically, you're the one who is making a quote-unquote citizen's arrest. You might need the help of law enforcement, but you're the one who are filing the charges. It is not it is not the law enforcement. You know, like especially when it comes to property crimes and so forth, or let's just say it's a burglary. But I don't know about actually making a citizen's arrest when such time you've not seen the crime here. So I know that Ro and Amelia are checking that out right now. Appreciate you calling. Ms. Faye, let's go to Herbie. Herbie, good morning.
Good morning, Rip and everyone. Rip, sometimes I like to use something I learned from someone else. Doc said the whole trial, I watched it. They muddied the water, as he would say. There were three things that stuck out that really let this kid off. The judge bias, the handpicked jury, which he handpicked it, and dropping that charge of a 17-year-old with an illegal weapon. See, if he'd have got charged for that particular charge, all the rest of them, he would have been found guilty of. By cleaning that one away.
Yeah, the problem.
You know, he shouldn't have been there with a weapon, and he's too young, so he shouldn't have done what he does.
Well, the problem was that the Wisconsin law had an angle to it. A 16-year-old that can have a rifle at a certain length. And did you know that the prosecutors did not introduce the weapon into evidence? And they probably didn't for that reason. So the judge let it. I understand why the judge dropped the charges or dismissed it, because it was a bit confusing. You would have to have the weapon into evidence to measure the length of the weapon, and they didn't. And if the weapon
thing would be in question, would be the handpicked jury, him reaching in there picking his own jury.
Yeah.
Now, when you say handpicked jury, we understand what he's doing.
Well, you know, you and I could agree with that.
Out here, there was nothing but theater, real. You know, the whole trial thing on TV is theater. It was theater when they went after Trump. For the impeachment. They do this to upset us out here. So we know what right and wrong is.
So let me understand. If you say it's theater, okay, I will. I'll give you an opportunity. But if you say it's theater, so you're going to suggest that the actors, all of them were participating and acting in this, and the reason,
they already knew the outcome. Uh-huh. That's the part of theater, the end.
Huh.
They write it.
Hmm. When you say they, who are they?
The one who orchestrated it, put it in theater.
Yeah, but I'm just trying to, you think that was the judge?
In order to do that. We didn't say this is the trial we want on TV.
Yeah. So do you think the fact that the judge had the same ringtone as the song that Donald John used in his rallies to come on to his rally sent a signal?
Well, yes. And for a fact, Will, let's get a little serious sometime and, you know, really look at the nut cut of it. That judge is just like all the rest of these judges out here that sends our kids to jail to find injustice and use justice to make injustice. You know, make you, it's a hit.
Well, how is he just like him?
Right.
How is he, when you say just like?
Well, you just mentioned it at the room tone. He's a trumper then.
Yeah. So you think that.
So you got a mindset. Hey, let me give you that on that ID and that card on my phone.
Yeah, go ahead.
As an American, as a veteran, and as a black man, I don't feel like I should have my ID on me, no card on me. I think I should have the freedom that they allow an illegal immigrant. When they come over here, they don't have to have ID. They don't have to get vaccinated. They don't have to follow these rules that these people are forcing on me.
Where did you get that information from?
Giving the freedom to some people that's crossing the line and taking the freedom from the people over here in America.
Where did you get that information from? Because if you come across the border and you don't have ID, that is not true what you just said, Herbie.
If
Herbie, you will. If you cross that border, you're going to be arrested.
The black people.
If you cross that border, Herbie, and you don't have, and if you don't have, if you cross that border, you're going to be arrested. Now, I mean, I could give you millions of individuals.
Come on, let's see the Mexicans crossing that border every day. All the people coming into our country and they ain't being arrested.
Where are you getting this? You realize how you're being manipulated, Herbie? Where do you get this information? You know, this is exactly what they you're talking about, the Trumpicans, this is exactly what they want you to believe. But trust me on this. There have been, look, don't take my word on it. I want you to go and check and see who has broke the record on arrest just this year since he's been in office. We're talking well above 1.5 million arrests have been made. So when you put that out there, and I obviously it's coming from Oxy Conservative Talk Radio, you've got to first ask yourself why it is they want Herbie to believe that. By the way, if you are not vaccinated and or have proof that you do not have COVID, trust me, that's enough not only to have you arrested, but taken back immediately to wherever you came from. Don't take my word for it. By the way, it was Donald John who came up with that executive order, and it's still in effect. We'll be back.
If you love listening to It's New Day, but you're unable to call in to make a comment, just log on to our chat room via the website. It is anewday.com or the JZ94.5 app in the Listen Live option.
Get the info. Get the info.
Stay informed. It's a new day with Rip Daniels, the number one talk show in South Mississippi on JZ94.5.
The name of this tune is Mississippi Goddamn. And I mean every word of it. Alabama's gotten me so upset. Tennessee made me lose my rest. And everybody knows about Mississippi Goddamn. Alabama's gotten me so upset.
All right, folks, here we go again. The Mississippi School Board Association is joining a few other states out there who are, they're withdrawing from the National School Board Association. Why? I'll tell you why. Because the National School Board Association sent a letter to Joe Biden saying, look, school board meetings have become places of siege and violence, and you've got school board members who are being threatened over critical race theory of all things, and most of the school board members don't know what the heck that is. And I mean literally being threatened. And there are those school board members, the School Board Association, the National, sees this as a national problem. And it is. Why? Because it's being prompted by conservative talk radio, the same ones who just told the last caller that people are not being arrested at the border. I mean, it's just, you know, it's amazing. But this is how they, meaning conservatives, are seeking to win re-election. They scare the bejesus out of would-be Caucasian participants, because the Negroes are coming now. They're going to come with critical race theory. They're going to teach you. They're teaching that your parents were and grandparents were oppressors just by your complexion. And they'll pull up a few little instances and examples of some obscure professor somewhere, Harvard, wherever. But yet here it is, Mississippi now withdrawing from the National. Why? I tell you why. Because Dictator Reeves has said so. Dictator Reeves says, okay, in this budget, he's going to put $3 million now to fight critical race theory. So asinine. And it's the same old diatribe that goes back to the good old boys that existed with Jeff Davis. No, we've got to keep them here. We've got to keep these folks under control, because if they're not on the plantation, they're going to come and they're going to take your daughters. They're going to compete with you, and you can't compete with them. Incomprehensible. All right, 228-896-9455, that's the number to call. I want to go to Miss Lee, push you to the front of the line. Sorry about that, witness. We'll get you next. Good morning, Miss Lee.
Good morning.
How are you, ma'am?
Okay, well, do that sound better?
Does what, ma'am?
I mean, it sounded fine when you were screaming, Miss Lee.
Do I sound better, Ro?
You sounded fine. You sounded perfect the first time, Miss Lee. Don't put on airs with us now. Come on now.
I think she sounds great.
Embrace that morning voice. No, okay. She sounded even better on the screen.
All right. I ain't going to say my feelings hurt. I'm going to just move on.
I apologize, Miss Lee.
Okay.
But what I said was
okay,
accurate.
Okay, I accept your apology.
Thank you.
Long story, Rip.
Yeah, I guess so.
But anyway.
I don't want to know.
Anyway, that's for off the air.
Is your husband asleep? I just want to.
Shit. What were you going to say, Ms. Lee? Would you want to come into?
He's not. Wide awake.
Hi, Mr. Allcorn Tackle. I mean, Farmer Tackle.
Hey, that was a compliment. That was a compliment, sir.
Okay. You know, I'm going to answer, first of all, on the verdict. I believe they got it wrong. It should have been premeditated murder. That's what he should have been charged with. Because, I mean, the way he come out there with the gun, not a concealed gun, but strapped his chest, his intentions were not to have a prayer meeting. And for his driver's license and vaccine card, I'd say no to that on my phone. For one thing, I might lose my phone. The second thing is I get pulled over for speeding. He's going to need my phone. And it might be stuff on my phone I don't want him to look at or see. So, well, I would say no to that.
That's an interesting thing. And now, but the thing here, I don't know whether you would give him your phone. That's an interesting question. You know, that is a thought. So what does this mean that the state trooper, let's say a state trooper stops you and he wants your license, right? And will he automatically be privy? Could he bump your phone and get all your information, or will he have to take it back to the car to get on the computer?
I'm thinking it's going to offer the same barcode that's on the back of your physical license. He just scan that and get your info. He doesn't have to have a reason.
Scan it on what,
phone.
Though?
They have a little thing they scan your license with.
Yeah, but what I'm saying is, do they do it there while he's standing there at the window, or would he have to take it back to his car?
That's a good question I'll ask.
I wouldn't feel comfortable with him taking my phone back to his car because he's going to have access, as Ms. Lee said, to everything. I mean, and then, of course, they've got this. You know what they have now? And I just found out about this. What is it? AirDrop or whatever it is where you can just AirDrop whatever to your phone.
Mm-hmm.
If you're in close proximity, I don't know.
For everyone, you just put it up there.
I hadn't weighed in.
Yep.
So you're not going to put your vaccination and or your credit. I mean, not your credit card. I'm sorry, but they do have credit cards on phones. But
Google Pay.
Yeah, but you're not going to put your license in it.
No, somebody could steal my car and my phone and all that. So I'm not quite comfortable with that right now. And Rip, the third thing, and you might have not watched it, Robin may have, on the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. You guys see that?
No, I did not.
The induction of Jay-Z?
No, I didn't see that.
Oh, okay.
How'd that go?
Well, I think y'all need to watch it.
Why?
David Chappelle, for one, presented him the award. They used the N-word so many times in front of company, I felt uncomfortable. Even Jay-Z used the N-word. I said, I didn't know they do this at the Rock and Roll Hall, whatever you call it, the Hall of Fame.
Yeah, Rock and Roll Hall of Fame.
Well, I mean, that's probably a big reason why he's even in the Hall of Fame.
There's a lot of N-words going around.
You know, I don't know when that's going to become. You know, it's just sickening. It's really, really sickening and disgusting for me that men like that, of their stature, will continue there. And, I know I'm not going to watch it now, but I'll get the transcript. I know we might chat about it. Appreciate you calling, Miss Lee.
Okay, have a good day.
Thank you, ma'am. All right, witness, I promise you next. We'll be back.
WJZD-FM Long Beach, Waveland, Gaucher, Gulfport, the all-new JZ94.5.
Mm-hmm. Here it is, the official Monday morning love song. I've always heard that two wrongs don't make a right. Sometimes they make happy.
If loving you is wrong, I don't wanna be right. If being right means being without you, I'd rather live a wrong doing life. Your mom and daddy say it's a shame. It's a downright disgrace. But long as I got you by my side, I don't care what your people say. Your friends tell you it's no future in loving a married man. If I can't see you when I want, I'll see you when I can. If love
If loving you is wrong, I don't want to be right.
Now, I'm here to tell you.
Am I wrong to fall?
This is Luther Ingram. He was killed by his wife, wasn't he?
Knowing I got a wife and two little children.
No, he wasn't killed. I'm just
kidding. Don't do that, man. Come on, man.
I'm just kidding. You had a rough weekend.
Bro.
Oh, you had a fun weekend.
Don't do that, man.
I won't do that. Bring it up.
Knowing I got someone else at home needs me just as much. And are you wrong to give your love to a married man?
All right.
And am I wrong for
this is a heck of a Monday morning love song. You just made it bad for a whole bunch of guys. And ladies out there.
They had fun all weekend. It's Monday, though.
Okay, it's time for a little man secret here, ladies. Every once in a while, I'll give you these little nuggets, little gems. I mean that literally. You see, what it boils down to a young man here who happens to be involved is this. You help him to do that, you see. You see, he's faced with an enigma, a question. What does he do when one woman doesn't believe he'll leave and the other woman doesn't believe he'll stay? Ooh, did you keep up with that? It's all about who's going to be the first to believe. You all right?
I'm great.
You okay with that?
Fantastic.
You want a piece of that?
No, sir. I think you laid out the secret plainly.
228-896-9455. That's the number to call. Every once in a while, I give these out. Thanks to Ms. Lee. Witness, I think. Look, Witness is next. Did we lose Bob? I don't see him on my screen. Bob, Witness, you're next.
Bob was back on one.
Good morning, Witness. Hello, Witness. You there? Yes, no, maybe so. Hello, hello, hello. All right, we'll put you on hold. Maybe he's got us on hold. I'll go to Bob.
Bobby.
Bobby. Good morning, Bobby.
Good morning, Rip. How you doing this morning?
Doing great, man.
Oh, man, appreciate you taking my call. Rip, I got a question for the jury, and I hope they look at this Arbery case. The most important things is he said out of his own mind he wasn't threatened by the man. So if you wasn't threatened by this man, why did you get out the truck with the gun? Why did you go get the gun? So obviously, if you wasn't a threat by him, you didn't need the gun. Number two, don't you have to see somebody do a crime in order to arrest them as a citizen or a regular police officer?
That's what the law said. That's what the law said at the time, yes. An officer
so he didn't see no crime at all?
No, he didn't see a crime. He suspected, he assumed, as well. He assumed, is what he did.
That means that they shouldn't even say that. He has no right to say that to him. That's what the jury has to look at. He didn't even see them commit no crime. Even the man that owned the house didn't even file no complaint or any charge or anything after he even saw him on videotape.
Right.
So he didn't even make a complaint. And then my last but not least.
Yeah, but let me try this on you here, Bobby, before you get to it.
Okay.
We're not discussing whether or not Arbery had committed a crime or not. We are discussing who shot him, really and truthfully, and who was responsible for that.
Yes.
Arbery's not, crime or no crime, he's not responsible for his death. The man had a shotgun trained on him, aimed at him while he stood there on the driver's side of his truck. Arbery veered off and went to the passenger side, and that's where Travis McMichael met him. Arbery had to defend himself with a man who had a pump. How did you do that? Well, you're going to grab that gun, put it away from you. There was no reason for that. And so we got to get past what Arbery did. This is why I call it the Arbery case, because in every case, like Huber and Rosenbaum, they were the ones on trial. Well, the one on trial is not them. The one on trial is the guy who killed them. And the guy who killed them, the question needs to be asked, was there a reason to kill them? Their reason is that they were fighting for their lives. Well, they put themselves in danger because they were endangering others by bringing the gun and aiming the gun at that person. And so I
100% agree with you, but for the jury-wise and the good old boy system dying now, that's why I was saying it like that, because the way we look at it, they definitely ain't gonna look at it like that.
You think Georgia? You have some apprehensions as to whether the jury is gonna come back with a guilty trial like the Rittenhouse, huh?
Yeah, I don't know, but I don't even want to. I did make a prediction on this thing, but I'm really nervous about this myself. So I don't even really want to do it now to myself, for real, because it's an up and down situation. I don't know, man. That's going to be a hard one. But my last thing about it was, if he went back and got the gun, ain't this more considered as premeditated murder?
Well, you mean both of them? Well, actually, I guess Travis did go back and get his shotgun. Well,
that's right. He went back and after he got up, and then went and got the gun that was in the room, loaded with his child in the house. It wasn't even in a safe or a lock, anything. He said he just went behind the door, right by the door, and grabbed his gun. So, I mean, it's out in the open, you know, fully loaded.
Here are the charges. All three are charged with one count of malice murder, four counts of felony murder, two counts of aggravated assault, one count of false imprisonment, and one count of criminal attempt to commit false imprisonment.
They should have thrown a manslaughter charge. Even if they couldn't get him on any of that, they might have got him on a manslaughter. But I feel like it should have been attempted murder in there, premeditated murder in there, because he got up and when he got the gun. You know,
well, that's a good point.
That should have definitely been enough.
That's a good point, Bobby. Let me ask you and you, Rip, this question. Do you think in both of these cases that they were charged accurately? Do you think they were overcharged or undercharged?
That's a good question.
I think with Rittenhouse, I can't pronounce the guy's name out of Kenosha. Rittenhouse. I think his one should have been first degree manslaughter. I think they should have had got that up there on him, and I think that they would have found him more guilty on manslaughter. Then, you know, instead of letting him go.
What about over here?
I think they undercharged him on that one right there.
What about with the three here?
I think they undercharged. Even though they got a bunch of charges, I think that they should have added manslaughter and premeditated murder on these guys down here, because they had to leave the comfort of their home to follow somebody. So that means the moment that you went and grabbed that gun, you're going to look for a problem. You don't go grab your gun to go hunt somebody down or follow somebody unless you know that you're willing to use this gun. So that's premeditated right there. You thought about this. Mm. If this person tried me, I'm going to shoot him today. That's what they had to say to themselves. If this person get out here and try me, guess what? I'm going to shoot him.
Could they prove that, though? Could they prove
it? Yeah, I think it was already proved, I believe. I think the prosecutor did an excellent job of showing that he admitted that Arbery was no threat.
Yeah.
Arbery was no threat.
That right,
so,
that's a big thing.
Yeah, so why would you feel the need to have a firearm? If you wanted to talk, put the firearm down and talk to the guy. There was no reason to have the firearm if he was no threat.
But that's on, ain't that strong arm, too? If I'm not mistaken, ain't that strong arm?
Well, it'd be strong arm robbery. You brought a gun, yeah. I mean, I would say it's brandished. He certainly brandished a weapon. But what the biggest thing in this case is that he literally followed Arbery. They tried to trap him. That's why it's false imprisonment. Attempted false imprisonment. Arbery was just trying to get away of these guys.
Yeah.
And they were insistent. Go ahead.
Well, I have one more question, but we talking about this right here. I know this was off topic, so but I heard you was talking about land and stuff earlier, Rip.
Yeah.
And why is it in the black community we focus on getting married, having kids, and buying a house, but why are we not teaching our young ones to not only buy a house but try to rack up on land much as possible? Why we're not teaching that in the household?
That's a good question. I'll answer. Appreciate you calling, Bobby. I don't know whether people are teaching that or not. I do know that there is not the kind of discussions that's going on as it comes to property ownership. I don't know whether you realize it, but African Americans have lost a significant amount of wealth in real estate and land. I mean, by the acres here in this state. I remember looking way back, what was it, 1998. That was the Realtors Association. The black realtors actually did a study to determine that African Americans were losing tens of thousands of acres per day. Primarily because, well, two reasons. Number one, taxes, lack of upkeep, and but the most important thing was probate. Unfortunately, many African Americans were dying without a will, and the family became family property, and no one took care of the taxes and the like. The question is, your question was why there's not more land discussion. I'm not in every household, but I do know that ownership is drastically down among African Americans, and even in rural African Americans. You have whole families used to have huge tracts of land, and dad would build houses for each of his children, and you had that kind of commitment. You don't have it now. You just don't. I'm seeing it as a realtor. I'm not seeing the kind of land ownership that you really normally should. And you know what else I don't see, Ro? And that is the enthusiasm on the part of your generation, actually, to actually own. It's almost as if you own land, you got work or something. And that's a really serious problem, too, Bobby. It's one that is we need to do a show on.
Or, and I hope the show includes this as well, I'll try to make it a point that it does, maintaining the land that you inherit.
Yeah.
And property, for that matter.
Yeah. Understanding the wealth, Bobby. I think the reason why there is not nearly as much enthusiasm is, it's sad to say it, but I think that young people altogether, Caucasian and African American, don't see the value of it. They don't see the worth. And it's, I was taught it in school. I mean, we had meets and bounds and discussions of real estate in school, actually, thanks to my, to the late Sidney Rushen. Let's get Glenn in. Glenn, good morning.
Hey, good morning, Rip. In reply to Herbie's call and comment earlier about the border crossings, for this year, so 2021, and this is straight off the U.S. Customs and Border Patrol website, there have been 1,734,686
arrests.
No. Encounters. See, it's talking heads like you that use the term.
Well, hang on, brother. Hang on.
It's not arrests.
Hang on.
It's encounters.
Well, then you need to read further. Read further, because those encounters include arrests and those individuals who are asking for asylum. Some of those were sent back because they were not vaccinated. Did you read further down the line?
Very few.
All right.
Very few.
Well, now, why don't you give the actual number? The number is there. Now, you started out giving numbers. Give the numbers.
I don't have that.
Well, did you just stop reading? Just because you just that talk? It is people like you who put forward just a little bit just to prove your position, and you need to stop being lazy. Go ahead, read further.
The administration uses the term encounters, and that's all they do.
All you got to do is read further, my brother.
On their way.
You will read that some of those individuals were arrested 2 and 3 times. So now what else is on your mind? Because you obviously have chosen to be lazy on this one. So what else is on your mind?
No, and I'm...
So there's nothing else on your mind?
Nope.
All right, thank you. I just proved beyond a shadow of a doubt that you do exactly what conservatives do, to get a little bit and quit. And then come out and go, oh, yeah, it's talking heads like you. When you see encounters, you do understand when you go before the Border Patrol, they got two choices. Number one, the choice is to turn you around, check, and make sure that you are or are not in violation. If you are in violation, you will be arrested.
Did you want those real numbers? Or?
Well, go ahead and give it to him.
Since January, since the Biden administration, those 1 million have attempted to cross the border legally, more than 1 million. Of that 1 million, 660,000 approximately have been sent back across the border, 410,000 taken into custody.
You want to call back now, Mr. Glenn? You want to call back and demonstrate just how truly ignorant you choose to be and how you do exactly what the Russian Limbubbers or the Hannity do? You can't do that on this show. They feed you that crap. You guys take it and run with it. And they only feed you the information that makes their story. That's why they're called conservatives. It's not objective.
They'll get a little, well, their encounters, that's what talking heads like you do.
Well, read down further and then call me and apologize. And apologize to my audience.
If you got your info from that Lori Roberts opinion piece, then doubly apologize, sir.
I mean, it's just, you know, you guys really, really, you got to see through this charade. You got to see through the charade. It's a charade. And it's all designed to do exactly what you just heard. And that is create an element of I got you for the other guy. Look, let me just tell you something. There's no doubt about the fact that the deporter in chief was President Barack Obama. You didn't hear Rush Limbaugh say that, but you did hear it. You did hear it on Mexican radio. I mean, they were all over this guy. You don't remember that interview? But to hear oxy-conservative talk radio, you would think, oh, God, yeah, well. But that's what they do. Now, you guys got to stop being gullible and are lazy. Just saying. Can I go to Witness? Oh, I'm sorry about that. I see Sapphire. Witness, good morning. I know you were on earlier. Good morning, Witness. You there? Last bite at the apple. Obviously, you either have it on, you got your phone set up something. I'm hearing something in the background. So maybe you got scared. Maybe next time. Let's go to Miss Sapphire. Good morning.
Hi. Good morning, and thank you for taking my call. And I would like to speak on the Arbery case compared to the Trayvon Martin case. And what is starting to really dawn on me is this idea of the jury of your peers. That jury was selected for a reason. Because if they sympathize with that, I'm not really sure what charges you will get on this man, because it's playing out by the attorney. They're playing on their sympathy. So the question mark is there, because in spite of the fact that he did nothing, I mean, Trayvon did nothing, until the gun shows up. When the gun shows up, everybody is scared for their life, because he was going to grab it and he was going to kill me with it. This is this new battle cry that we have to keep our eyes on, because, in fact, he did absolutely nothing until he pulled out that gun. So all this guy is trying to plead with us all is that, but when he saw the gun, he tried to grab it. Now, it's going to really depend on that jury, but if they come back with less on these people than they should, what do you do? If that whole community feels like that's okay. We're in a place where we need to really realize that we need to be voting for our judges.
Yeah.
And we need to keep our eyes on this ball, because there's some messages being sent here. And that's all I wanted to say, Rip. Yeah, right. Okay.
Appreciate it, Miss Sapphire. I want to go to let's go to the trial right now. The defense is now doing their closing arguments.
As possibly being homeless and living under the bridge. Travis explained to you that he had learned about a neighbor having her purse stolen. Of course, there were other complaints of crime in the neighborhood as well.
All right, okay. So it is. The prosecutor was accurate with her assertions what the defense is going to do and say, okay, look, they were trying to stop some crime, and there was no assaults now, you realize. You'd be surprised to know, too, that within a year prior to Travis McMichael doing this, you're really looking at only four incidents of something being stolen. One of those was his gun, who he suggested that a neighbor got, who was driving a truck. That neighbor, by the way, is Caucasian. So that's what's going on here. So now what we've got to do is suspect that it's got to be Arbery, after all. You know, you would think, ladies and gentlemen, with all that is said in the 75 days before charges were filed against Arbery, that all they had to do, all the law enforcement had to do, was go to his house and find some of the stolen stuff. Nothing was revealed. Nothing. But what bothers me more than anything else is that we get duped into trying to evaluate whether Arbery was deserved to be shot. Absolutely not. He was jogging. Had on jogging shoes, jogging apparel. I can tell you one thing now, if I was in that neighborhood or any other neighborhood, when I jog, I certainly will have to be armed. That's what will send a signal if these guys are not found guilty. just as I feel that if, in fact, I'm in a protest, you can best better believe I will be armed. Just going to let you know that, and it needs to be very visible. Just sling it over your shoulder. So now that's where we're going to go, America. We're now going to have legions, thousands of individuals taken to the streets in a peaceful protest, armed to the hilt. Now, trust me on this. It's not if, it is when that happens. And by the way, you know, my only hope is that when it does happen, there will be some common sense gun laws. Common sense gun laws about open carry. We're setting ourselves up. You want to finish this on the screen, or did I do it? Okay, I'm sorry. That was on my end. Pardon me. Let's go to, who is it? Yeah, we got some gremlins this morning.
Yeah, please try three again so we can see if we can figure this out.
Yeah, all right. Oh, so three? All right, let's see. Good morning, witness. How are you?
Good morning, Rip. The Kyle Rittenhouse case has set a few precedents about self-defense that are kind of important. The first one is that usually self-defense will require someone, the person who has been harmed in the incident, to have a weapon out also. So, you know, now you'll be able to defend yourself without the person having to have a weapon opposing you.
Well, now, that's not a precedent. You realize that happened in Trayvon Martin. Trayvon Martin had no weapons. You realize that, right? So there's no precedent set here. There's no precedent. Go ahead.
Okay. Well, usually, you know, the self-defense is, you know, the other person has a weapon. But then also, in the Arbery case, the fact that they didn't stop him and corral him and then he got away and they shot him makes it all futile. It is self-defense because he had an option to run away.
And he tried that.
Just like the guys with Rittenhouse had an option not to continue to taunt him or do whatever they were doing.
Rittenhouse
had a chance to turn around and run the other way.
Rittenhouse's case has been settled. The verdict has come down. But
when Bryan was chasing him,
Ahmaud Arbery did exactly what you said. He was cut off. The hunt continued. They chased him for 5 minutes. He got tired of running away, attempting to run away from a guy in a truck. Three guys, as a matter of fact. Two of them armed. Two of them armed.
He wasn't necessarily cut off. You do. Two other directions.
Have you even seen all the 5 minutes?
You do understand now,
wouldn't
you?
Absolutely, I have. 100 times.
Well, good. If you have, then you could see that he was confronted with a shotgun. Did you see the shotgun aimed at him from the truck?
Absolutely. We talked about that Friday.
Did you see it?
I did see the man in the back of the truck holding the gun on him. Now, had he been on the ground with it, it would have been different. But Ahmaud Arbery was not stopped. He could have turned around and ran the opposite way.
So,
and that means a total different thing.
And let me ask you this.
When you have an animal pinned in, that means he has nowhere to go.
You do understand.
When you have a person pinned in, it means the same thing.
Let me just ask you a simple question now. Move on, brother. Do you think Arbery could outrun a bullet?
No, but okay. He could have tried. It would have been better than running through the gun.
Do you not think, you realize Bryant was behind him? And the McMichaels were in front of him.
He ran around the truck to the gun.
He ran around. And the other
blocking his way on the side of the truck. He ran around the truck to the gun, grabbed it, and then he went to the side of the street.
You do understand. Well, let me just make sure. Did you see McMichaels, Travis McMichael, on the driver's side first, aiming the gun? And did you see?
And you didn't either.
Well, thank you very much. Fine. Look, I'm not going to play these games with you. You could go and watch. The reality is you're on the road. You've got houses on both sides of the road. Now, when you see McMichaels on that side and then you see him go to the other side, when such time that Arbery ran to the other side, he was evading the man on the driver's side of the truck. His daddy was in the rear of the truck. Let me go to Philip. Good morning, Philip.
Good morning, Rip. I was very pleased to hear the Rittenhouse verdict on Friday. I'm looking forward to Rittenhouse suing all kinds of media and collecting all kinds of money for that. And hopefully he puts that money to good use.
So, sue them for what?
Well, lying about him.
What did they say that was wrong?
Well, one of the things that the President of the United States said when he was running was that Kyle was a white supremacist.
And when he's throwing up gang signs for white supremacist groups like the Proud Boys, yeah. Surrounded by Proud Boys, noted white mm-hmm. supremacists, what would you call that? What's the WP hand sign stand for, sir? If I throw up a crown, you better believe I'm repping GD, you know what I'm saying?
It stands for the same thing that it stands for, 99.99%.
You know what it stands for, don't you, Philip?
Right.
You know what it stands for.
Right. Well, you know what it means?
I love to hear you get
I'm
going
to throw a pitchfork in your face, but I ain't repping, though. You know what I'm saying?
He called him a white supremacist, but yet here's a guy giving the white supremacist side, and you go,
we'll put a C on your forehead, but I ain't cripping at all.
Well,
it's
a sign that says, I'm okay when you're scuba diving. That means I'm okay.
Yeah, because they're so deep underwater, surrounded by these white supremacists, right? Come on, man.
It's also a Kappa sign, too, isn't it? Yeah.
We'll see. Just like the guy that Roe, who was able to see into his mind and knew that he was smirking at the American Indian.
Which he was. No. Hey, bro. Hey, nah, you ain't finna call me out, and I'm not going to respond to you, Philip. He was smirking. That's photographic evidence. You want to go look at the picture?
And he won. He sued.
He still smirked, though.
No. Anyway.
Yeah. He sure did.
I don't know what that's
He did, though. You know the guy that was confronted by the old native guy? The old native veteran?
That I listen to people talk about this, the Rittenhouse case. And a lot of people are thinking that he should have been convicted, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, because they believe the untruths that are being propagated by the media, including you. You said this morning that Rittenhouse's mother drove him to Kenosha. And that's untrue. He drove himself there.
And where did you get that information? From Rittenhouse,
from
I bet.
Trial.
No, you got from that from trial. Rittenhouse, the lying boy.
From the trial.
The lying boy Philip, you do hear.
What you're saying.
What I'm saying is that Rittenhouse, what you heard is what Rittenhouse says. That was no evidence to show quite the contrary.
And since you've determined that everything that Rittenhouse says must be a lie,
yeah.
That must be a lie, too.
Well, you're exactly. I've got some proof that he lied.
Really?
Well, sure. You didn't hear all the lies he said on the witness stand? You got a guy who said that he was an EMT, was he?
No.
Okay. Did he lie?
Fireman.
Is that a lie? All right, what else you got?
Did you say no?
What else? Come on, what else? What else?
Judge Schroeder over here.
Jesus Christ.
The fact is that one of your callers last week said that his mother drove him with the AR-15 to Kenosha, and that is also a lie.
And can you prove that? Who said it wasn't?
Yes,
who said that it wasn't? Where'd you get that? So tell me what proof you have that he did not bring the AR-15.
Because the AR-15 never left Wisconsin.
How do you know?
Because it came out in the trial.
Because Rittenhouse said so. He is the only one who said that. That did not. There was no evidence. Black, the man that bought the gun, did not go on the stand.
Right. Because he didn't have to.
So you believe the white guy. So you believe the white guy.
Okay, so, right. White people always lie.
I'm just simply saying that's the only reason you have. You believe the 18-year-old white guy because you know the gang signs, don't you? Thank you very much. We'll be back.
Get the info.
Stay informed. It's a new day with Rip Daniels, the number one talk show in South Mississippi, on Jay-Z 94.5.
Opinion here, folks. The defense is now in the Arbery case, making its presentation to the jurors as to why three Caucasian males armed with a pump shotgun and a .357 and two vehicles, a car, and a truck.
Tire irons, whatever tools on board.
What was that they had to defend themselves against a 164-pound, 5'10" jogger who happened to be African-American? Now, if that's self-defense, ladies and gentlemen, we're in big trouble. And trust me on this, it's going to say some very, very clear things, especially with the Rittenhouse case. But based on the last caller, it really does boil down to this. Who do you believe? And then trust me, that belief is prejudiced by who you trust right off the bat. In other words, you know, it goes down to whiteism and blackism, folks. It really, really does. I don't doubt that I have far more in common if I went before a jury with any and every African-American than I do a Caucasian. You got me? If, in fact, the jury is Caucasian or mostly black. You understand what I'm saying to you? That doesn't mean that everyone there is going to be prejudiced. It just simply means you have some things in common, and that is condition. The conditions that an average African-American will have experienced would be present. You got me? So what that last caller proved was he'd take the word of a 17, 18-year-old boy and says, okay, it's gospel. Yeah, this is what happened, rather than, and no proof whatsoever. No proof whatsoever. The benefit of the doubt was given to him.
Yeah, and then, I mean, they're acting like this was proven throughout testimony and other witnesses coming forward to corroborate what he's saying. No, you just heard that from Kyle.
Yeah. And the truth of the matter is that, you know, Kyle understood, and I'm sure his mother understood, the implications here of allowing her son to go to a riot or driving her son to a riot, allowing him to have an AR-15 in that environment. You should ask, where was his daddy? Did you notice I didn't see his daddy throughout this trial.
I've never seen Mike Rittenhouse.
You should ask about that. I don't know. I don't have no reason for wondering, except, you know, if it was an African-American on trial and daddy wasn't there, that would be quite telling, wouldn't it? So where is his daddy? Why is daddy not here? I don't know. But I can tell you one thing. I'm not going to give his daddy the benefit of the doubt. You realize he and his mother were estranged. She was a single parent. He was not a Boy Scout by any stretch of the matter. Well, of course, I guess he's not. Of course, he could be, I guess, the way he was whimpering. Oh, you can sue me for it if you want. It's a good description. 228-896-9455. But it does boil down to that. Who do you believe? The jury right now is going to believe the McMichaels and Roddy Bryan, or are they going to believe Arbery? He's dead. And that's how you give the benefit of doubt. When you hear Travis McMichael says, I was scared. Do you automatically assume that Arbery was not? You automatically assume he was not? He's not the one with the gun. I was scared. Heaven forbid. And this is what my parents taught me way back when. I'm talking when I came back, when we moved from Biloxi to Hansborough. They're afraid of you, and there's no defense. In other words, the biggest concern that African Americans had during Jim Crow was making one of them afraid. It sounded like that wolf whistle there in Money, Mississippi. Because the truth is that out of fear, they can do literally anything and get away with it. With impunity. In those days.
In those days?
And nowadays, it seems the same.
I mean, all you gotta do is tap into the fear.
That's it. That's exactly it. And look, your complexion is not going to save you. Didn't save Lausa. Remember her? After the Edmund Pettus Bridge, she comes down, mother of, what, 8?
Mm-hmm. Reeb.
Caucasian female, shot, gunshot blast. No one knows. Two ministers, Caucasian both, beaten to death there at the Edmund Pettus in Selma. No one knows. Of course, the person who beat him was defending himself, I'm sure. But it depends on who you believe. Who do you believe? And I must tell you, a lot of that is born out of our own prejudices. And who do we trust? It's born out of our own prejudices. It does. It's not unusual for an African-American to go to Central Park and ask another African-American for directions as opposed to a legion of Caucasians there. It's not unusual. It really isn't. Same thing with Caucasians. It's not unusual for Caucasians to go to Central Park and not ask an African-American, but instead ask a Caucasian. It's not unusual. It has nothing to do with your being a racist. It has more to do with your lightness. It has more to do with, you know, you want to ask someone who has, in your view, some reasonable chance of understanding you, period. 228-896-9455. I want to go to Lolita. Lolita, good morning.
Good morning, and good morning to your listeners. Mm-hmm. For those who can't believe what happened in the trial with Rittenhouse and those two gentlemen that he murdered, think back on Trayvon Martin. This country was founded on violence and guns, period. And it'll continue to happen because of those individuals that we deal with on a daily basis in this country. And when you have people in charge, like when Trump was in the White House, spewing the chaos and rhetoric, it will continue to go on. And it's like, how do we get past this and how do we change it? By continuing to fight with and doing what's right. And anytime a person of another race is in the fight with the African Americans about what's right, will be gunned down like those two guys did. Or
you think it's going to have a cooling effect on Caucasians participating in any kind of protest, Black Lives Matter or otherwise?
It would probably, for those who are looking at it and are afraid, but for those who don't care and who want to be about the right thing and see the injustices, they'll continue to protest.
Yeah. Why do you think it was? This is very interesting. I was quite moved by the multicultural participation during all of those movements from Louisville to Kenosha to Milwaukee to, I mean, even here on the Mississippi Gulf Coast, it was a very, very mixed group of protesters, very young, Caucasians and African Americans, but very, very, very committed, very verbal. And by my seeing that implied to me that there was significant change in how Americans across the board see what's right and what's wrong. So now you've had this verdict, and there are some multiracial protests in areas here in and around the coast, but you're not seeing nearly the kind of reactions that probably you could very well have if, in fact, these McMichaels and these guys get off scot-free just like Rittenhouse. Why do you think that is?
I think, you know, that people are getting tired and frustrated, continue to see these acts played out over and over again. And if they stop really protesting against the injustices, we're going to have a serious problem within this country. And what's frustrating for me at times, and when you made mention about the protesters out there on the coast, multicultural, I did see that. And what was disappointing for me a little bit at times, where I saw more of our Caucasian brothers and sisters than our people of color out there.
Yeah, well. Right is right, wrong is wrong, regardless of the complexion. Appreciate you calling, Miss Lolita.
Thank you.
There's someone has asked me about whether or not I think there's be riots in Brunswick. You know, I don't know whether that. I think what you have and what we have seen is the reaction to police brutality, not individual brutality, which is why I didn't think I'd see too much in the way of a protest in Rittenhouse. But you do realize when there's a police involved shooting, then that police officer represents all of us. It's a government then we're being put upon by the government. But in a case like there in Brunswick, Georgia, or in Kenosha, it is civilians. Now, needless to say, I think, and I agree with one caller who suggested that the jury was a bit theatrical. I wouldn't call it theater, though. I would actually call it a kangaroo court. I don't think they did it to perform for television. I think it was a foregone conclusion that they were going to do, they, meaning the powers that be, particularly the judge, was going to do everything humanly possible to see to it that Rittenhouse got off. And I wonder, really, whether or not whether the prosecutor participated in that sham, you know? So, all right, hang on. We'll be back. Galloway, you next.
Download the free Jay-Z 94.5 app to your smartphone. The People Station, Jay-Z 94.5.
If you love listening to It's a New Day, but you're unable to call in to make a comment, just log on to our chat room via the website, itisanewday.com, or the Jay-Z 94.5 app in the Listen Live option.
Get the info. Get the info.
Stay informed. It's a New Day with Rip Daniels, the number one talk show in South Mississippi, on Jay-Z 94.5.
Of the evil that lurks within. Smiling faces, sometimes they don't tell the truth. Smiling faces tell lies.
Reasonable and probable grounds of suspicion, probable cause. Travis said many, many times it was the totality of the circumstances. That's his Coast Guard brain. That's his Coast Guard brain saying everything that I knew gave me the belief that a crime had been committed. Escape. Private citizen's warrant arrest must occur immediately after the perpetration of the offense, or in the case of felonies, during escape. Not every person is arrested at the moment they commit a crime. Not every person is arrested by police, because sometimes the police don't get there in time. But if they learn about the person and they have information about the person, escape can happen anytime. Escape can happen later.
So this is the defense attorney.
It doesn't have to happen right at the same time the crime is committed.
On behalf of the three defendants there in the Arbery case. And Arbery is still on trial while being dead. 228-896-9455, that's the number to call. Show it's called It's a New Day, One Rule. There's no such thing as a right or wrong opinion. Let me ask this question of you, and I'll go to the phones. Guy following you with a Confederate battle flag on his truck.
Again?
Is there a reason for you to think that your life is being threatened?
Absolutely. Even if I didn't work here.
See, again, that goes back to what you believe.
Yeah.
You got me? It really does, ladies and gentlemen. And I'm going to tell you, that was a time during the hippie, yippie, irresponsible, bearded, smelly kid movement when you had individuals right here in Mississippi who, because they had that Confederate battle flag, you better not have your hair longer than your collar. Caucasian and otherwise. In other words, this is not just about race. This is about the culture of that, the Confederate mindset and the culture. And I talk about it all the time. I mean, there were just as many Caucasians who died during the Civil War as African Americans, but they were in uniform. The blue ones, just so you know. Those were the ones that counted. They were on the right side of history. But there's no doubt about the fact that what this defense attorney is doing is saying, hey, y'all, you know, my guys thought the crime had been committed, and they did what any other law-abiding citizen would do. They grabbed a gun and tried to help the popo. And there was no reason for them to believe that this 164-pound, 5'10", black guy could not best them. So they got their guns and they had to use it. Because they know that there's no way that we two over 250-pound, well, about 235-pound men plus a two-ton truck, a ton-and-a-half truck, one-ton car, we just couldn't handle this superhuman strength of this Negro. 228-896-9455. Galloway, you're next. Good morning.
Hi, good morning, Mr. Dane. How y'all doing down there?
Doing well.
Okay, first of all, before I get started, I just want to congratulate the Jackson State Tigers and the fans and supporters of Mississippi HBCU football this weekend.
Really?
I hosted a watch party. I had about over 20 people at my house, and they have never seen a HBCU game like that. Really? There was only one gentleman. Excuse me, sir?
So you watched the halftime, too?
Oh, yeah. ESPN Plus, the app, it shows the full halftime, you know, where they brung out Lil Boosie and Alcorn made fun of the Jackson State chant, and Jackson State made fun of the Alcorn chant. That was very entertaining, sir.
I hear you.
Yeah, it was one for the ages. They, you know, the people said they have never seen, you know, 60,000 or 58,000, whatever the actual number was, never seen nothing like that. I said, you know, that brings it back to the 70s, you know, the 70s and the 80s when HBCU football games was the thing to see.
That's true.
You know, go to, you know.
Word.
Oh, you plan. So. You still plan for it. I mean, but you're right. That's when, you know, of course, those days, HBCUs were only the schools that African-Americans could attend. So they were even bigger than this. I don't doubt. I mean,
yes.
Jackson was shut down. There's no doubt.
Yeah, and Coach Prime said something at when they interviewed him after the game, and he said everybody in the city of Jackson should have made some money today, from the you know, Uber driver, cab drivers, mom and pop restaurants, hotels. So it was a big. I really wanted to see the numbers that they made, because they said if it was 60,000 inside, it was another 20,000 outside.
Oh, absolutely, so it's always that way. Yeah, if
yeah,
I went,
a lot of people down there.
You know, if I went to Jackson to HBCU game, I probably wouldn't go to the stadium. I'd just assume go to the parties around the stadium. I got friends I'd probably hang out with, the Blackmans or somebody like that, and just it's a party in every yard, just about. You know, to be quite frank,
every corner. Yeah, you're right about that. Because I will definitely be at the SWAC championship game on December 4th.
Hang on, Galloway. Hang on. I'll get you after Jazz at 11.
WJZD-FM Long Beach, D. Iberville, Pascagoula, Biloxi, the all-new JZ94.5.
Time for Jazz at 11. I like this. So is this the record of the guitar player or the horn player?
Guitar player. Jake Bass.
Jake Bass.
Detroit's very own.
That sounds like Detroit.
Eminem's buddy.
I like this horn player too.
His dad, Jeff, is also on the track.
Really?
Jake started playing by ear at age 8, composing at age 13.
Really? That's okay. All right, you got to send that one to me.
Got it.
All right, folks, good morning to you, little jazz batazz. Our way of keeping the music alive. You got to keep playing now. Don't put your axe down. You need to keep playing your axe. Every once in a while, you could have blow a little tune or hit a few rips. You know what I mean? Makes all of us happy. I'm just going to tell you. 228-896-9455. That's what I'm calling. It's Monday. We're getting caught up on all the stuff that happened over the weekend. Been a lot of stuff. Of course, the Rittenhouse jury came in, and it really was the Rittenhouse jury. No doubt about that. Innocent on all counts. And now the closing arguments are continuing with the Arbery case, and we are waiting with bated breath. By the way, there's also another case that's going on. I don't know if it's televised. It's the civil case against the White and Furious there in Charlottesville. Several of them have been sued now for causing a ruckus, and which resulted in the death of Heather Hare. And they're not apologetic about it either, I can tell you that. So we're going to be watching that as well. Let's go back to Galloway, who's been patient enough to wait through the weekend. Appreciate it, Galloway.
No problem, Mr. Daniels. I enjoy listening to jazz at 11, so it's pretty soothing the soul. But real quick, though, on the two cases, the one that's over with the Rittenhouse case, I really wish people would go back and read Jonathan Daniels and Tom Coleman during the civil rights era, what happened in Alabama. So it's kind of similar, but it's, you know, Tom Coleman was a white and furious mm-hmm. who shot Jonathan Daniels and used self-defense. Mm-hmm. And he was found not guilty.
Really?
So the more things change, the more things stay the same in that case. Now, this case that's going on right now, like I was telling Rose, I spent 8 years of my adult life in the state of Georgia, in the United States military. And it was told to us, and it was very instilled in my brain, in certain places that you don't go in Georgia. And Southeast Georgia is one of them. I'm not saying every person in Southeast Georgia is like those three idiots that's on trial, but it's a lot of people that have sympathy for people like those, the McMichaels and Roddy Bryan. So I'm at a toss-up, with overwhelming facts, because I think the prosecution did a great job, but I just don't know if 11 of them will say, yeah, they did it, and we need to throw them away. That's just my opinion. Maybe I'm wrong. I think they are guilty. I know they are guilty. I've seen that they are guilty. But that jury in Southeast Georgia, that place is still in the throwback, and you brought out a great point. That Confederate battle flag, emblem that he had on that tag, that old Georgia flag, that means something around that point. I don't know where we go from here.
All right, appreciate you calling. Wall of preachers was outside too, including Jesse Jackson, L. Sharpton, and every other preacher there in and around Brunswick was there over the weekend as well, as they should. But he brings up an interesting point. I don't mind telling you, the jury pool is all Caucasian, with the exception of one African American. It has to be a unanimous decision, be it guilt or innocence. So how do you think this is going to come out, bro?
I think that, as you spoke on earlier, prosecutor in this case has done a head and shoulders above and beyond better job than what we saw in Wisconsin And I think it's going to go a long way. I also think the back and forth between the judge and the defense on who can and who can't be in the jury or in the courtroom is also going to go a long way, but not the way that McMichael and Brian's lawyers think. I think that they're going to clearly be shown for attempting to further bias the jury after the shenanigans they pulled on even choosing the jury. That the judge himself acknowledged.
I want to go to it right now. Hang on, Bedrock. We're going to get you, I promise.
Originally in the door jam, but he told you, as Mr. Arbery came closer, he did this and made him change direction. Now he's coming. He's wavering on the road. And so Travis is walking away. He's backing up. He's not charging at him. He's backing up to try to create space and distance. He has this gun here, and he is literally watching him. We see his foot plant right there, and Travis is thinking to himself, please turn, please turn, please turn. That's what he told y'all, that's what he told Nohilly. Please turn into this yard. Please don't come at me. I am backing up. I'm just trying to keep an eye to make sure you, please don't come at me. And as he comes around to the far side of the truck, he can't see him. He's backed up over here, but so he's stepped up over here to try to get a look at what's happening because he's afraid that Mr. Arbery is going to be down or finally go for the gun or seek cover or something. Please turn, please turn. Please go off into this yard. He never, ever, when he left his driveway that day, thought that things would end this way. Not ever.
All right, folks. Yeah, this is exactly what I just got through talking to and a caller about that refuses to see it. Exactly. He's expecting for the guy who's going his way. He's running, has evaded them, trying to get home. This Arbery trying to get home. He's expecting for Arbery to turn. He's the one that's blocking Arbery from going. It's just incomprehensible. And there are those who would believe this.
Well, we heard from some.
He expected for Arbery to stop and speak to him. I guess shake his hand like in Django. I mean, it's you know, folks, it's just, and to make the argument is so classic. Classic.
Well, yeah, because they have to acknowledge what we were talking about.
It's classic privilege. And there, it's just sad that you'll find a Negro, the smartest Negro in the world, who believe this. It's just incredible. But nevertheless, it takes all kinds here, bro. Let's go to Uncle Mike, then we'll get Bedrock and the rest of you guys. Good morning, Uncle Mike.
Good morning, Rip. Let's go back to the O.J. Simpson case when he was acquitted. And all the Negroes were very happy that happened. Now, there was a white guy. He was liberal. He says, Well, blacks so happy that O.J. was acquitted. And I said, well, O.J. didn't do anything for the black community I know of. I mean, you know. But we were glad that whites got to taste the spoonful of crap that we've been eating for years. And I just think he was taken aback, like, I still don't understand. This has been going on for centuries. And now that you've got a taste of what it feels like, then you can't understand. And I got to say, you know, since we don't know that there's any other intelligent life in the universe, I have to say, I'm wanting to hear from the smartest Negro in the galaxy on his decision.
Appreciate you calling, Uncle Mike.
Okay.
So I'm going to surmise by that you think that O.J. got away with murder. I mean, there's no doubt O.J. did not play innocent very well in my book.
Why would you write a book about the murder that you didn't commit like you committed it? And called it, if I had done it, come on, Juice.
Talk about arrogance. Where is he now, anyway?
I think, you know what? I just saw OJ over the weekend. He was commenting on the Tiger King fiasco on the Tiger King this season. Yeah. Yeah, he thinks Carole Baskin did it.
I don't know.
I mean, he would know, right?
I don't know what Tiger King is. I don't know what that is. So OJ's back in Florida on his
I don't know. They were just interviewing different so-called celebrities about the reaction to the first season of Tiger King, and that was his take on it.
Bedrock, good morning. How are you?
Good morning, Ro. Good morning, Reverend Ro. It's interesting that you was talking about the OJ. So those are one of the first cases I really kept up with, and I really don't believe OJ done it. I don't think they had the had evidence. However, that makes me want to talk about what I want to talk about. Alito, Judge Alito, he was bizarre. But this judge in Wisconsin, I mean, he's over the top.
Yeah.
I think there was judicial overreach and a lot of jury tampering and a lot of stuff. People should be up and on and marching. Now, these other boys over here, Georgia, Alabama, I don't think they're going to make it. They're going to get convicted. But this other case, it sets a dangerous precedent. You know, what they should ask themselves, these Trumpians, what they should ask themselves, you know, the next protest, if we had a militia of black and brown people, like Muslims, anybody, but you know, they don't like black and brown Muslims. So what if they had some of those people armed to the teeth in the trees and all about just to protect those ones that want to protest? And they see a white boy walking down the street with an AR, and they feel threatened, they shoot him. That's the precedent you done set. And I have a feeling it's going to happen. I mean, just like the guy on the Young Turks, I believe it. I hope that I'm not right, but everybody have guns. Everybody have all types of the lethal weapons. And it's going to be ugly. Because you done just set a precedent because you want to let somebody out.
I think you make a legitimate point. I think you make a legitimate point. I think that you've got three Caucasian males who've been shot, one of which was had a license to carry, but did not shoot. I don't doubt that things are going to change now on the street when someone's looking to protest, and you know. I could tell you firsthand, the first time that really became national news was when Ronald Reagan was sitting there in the State House in Sacramento and in California, and the Black Panther Party for Defense came into his office, came into the building. They changed the laws in California that day.
That was during the time we was leaving California. I was a kid when that happened. I remember that. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
We had a sofa celebration here. This weekend, all 60,000 of us, and you should have been here. Should have seen it. Thank you for taking my call.
All right, brother. Thank you. 228-896-9455. Again, the defense attorney is doing his closing arguments. What's going to be interesting, you realize you've got three defendants here, and there has been very minimal questioning, actually, on the part of each of the lawyers that represents each. Goff represents Rowdy Bryant, and then a husband and wife team represents Greg, Mr. Ponytail over there. I can't think of his name, but I'm just curious as to whether each one of these defense attorneys are going to then give their closing arguments. If so, then it's going to last for a while.
Well, the prosecutor mentioned that they're going to be getting sheets on each. So it's not like the verdicts are going to be together. They're all going to be separated. They're going to be ruling what they're guilty or not guilty of as individuals.
Well, again, yeah, I understand that, but I guess I'm just curious.
So I'm just saying it would behoove them to try to present three different closing arguments, I would think.
You know what's interesting about this is that theoretically, I don't remember any of the other, and by the way, I didn't watch this, you know, completely. So if some of you can correct me on it, I'd appreciate that. I don't remember any of the other the defendant attorneys calling any witnesses per se. The main one has taken the lead has been Travis's attorney. I guess Travis has most to lose, one could argue, but all of them are being charged with the same thing. One count of malice murder, four counts of felony murder, two counts of aggravated assault. Even Roddy Bryan, who supposedly did not pull a gun on Aubrey, is also being charged with murder. Everybody, they're looking at this as if everybody involved with this murder, and they're right. But, you know, the jury's going to decide on any of the counts. One count of malice murder, four counts of felony murder. I guess the malice murder maybe would be Travis McMichael. Four counts of felony murder. I don't know. That's kind of an interesting kind of charge. Let's get Big Chief. Big Chief, good morning. Where are you, brother?
Hey, can you hear me real?
Yes, sir, I can. Yeah, you're a little bumpy, but we can hear you.
I'm outside of Beaumont, Texas.
Outside of Beaumont. Heading home, heading this way, or heading the other way?
Heading to the house. Heading to the house, man, for the rest of the week.
Man, that's good, brother. I'm glad to hear you're going to be home for Thanksgiving, man, and get off that road. I hope you safe travels there. What's on your mind?
Oh, Rip, it's just, I just keep looking at all these court cases that's going on in the country, Rip. The system's just not set up for black men and women in this country. It never has. I just never believe in justice in this country. You have a few different justices that, you know, go our way here and there in a way, but it's not set up for us, Rip. You just go get your gun, get your AR-15, whatever you want to get, and be ready. Because by them letting this guy off, Rittenhouse, whatever his name is,
yeah,
it's just vigilantes is going to be all over the place, Rip. And you got the people in Georgia. They might let them off over there, Rip. We're in a corner here, Rip.
Yeah. We're
in trouble.
Look, I hear what you're saying. If the roads were followed, if it was vice versa, right, and if you had Caucasians getting the kind of onslaught of shootings and so forth, I mean, in total now, just, and I'm not even going to say Caucasians. I'm just going to say moderate-thinking Americans, period. Because the Rosenbaum and Huber were obviously Caucasian. So was Gus Cruz. But the truth is that any reasonable-thinking person has to now ask themselves whether it's safe for them to not be armed and not be deliberate in whatever their defense is. Because I think you make a legitimate point. You've got an element out there who's just looking to shoot somebody and just looking for any reason to become a hero. And I really think that's what Rittenhouse was all about, and I think that's what McMichael was all about. They listen to Oxy Conservative Talk Radio and the Dog Network and think they're just going to go out and get one. And we'll show them. We're going to show them. We're going to take our country back. I mean, they had a president that believed this much. You're going to take our president. We're going to take our country back. We're going to stop you dead. And that combined with the straw man tactics of conservative talk radio, they know what that person looks like. You know, he's a liberal. Which is another word for being Liberian, or Liberian looking, let's put it that way, in their view.
What do you do? You have the judge to put his thumb in the scale on the trial. He biases. I mean, he turned the trial, and he went in a whole different way and put his thumb on everything, Rip, and that didn't help at all either. And broad daylight, he did this.
Well, and he did it because he's the most senior judge, and I don't doubt that if truth were to be told about what happened in Kenosha, I do not doubt that there may have been some shenanigans behind the scenes. I really believe that. That whole bring the box out, let Rittenhouse pull the names, we still have not confirmed, have we, bro, where he has done that in another trial?
No, we have not.
It was said on television that he's done in other trials, but we just have not found it.
No examples have been presented.
We have not found those. And it may exist, but we have not seen it. If it was that prevalent, I'm sure we'd be able to find it pretty easily. Well, look, let not your heart be troubled, my friend. I can tell you that there is a, you know, there are those of us and who are like you who understand the seriousness of it and going to do more to participate. Appreciate your calling. Big G. I mean, look, folks, this is the kind of stuff that if the Tea Party was being treated this way, then trust me, they would be up in arms, literally. This is the kind of stuff that the Oath Keepers would wish would happen to them to justify their existence. It really is. I mean, these folks are having to create a battle cry, critical race theory. They're having to create some kind of injustice being put upon them. This is real for us. There is no doubt about the fact that the three individuals in Georgia have the support. Look, you realize how much money they raise? Oh, we're talking hundreds of thousands of dollars, these guys, to defend them. And by the way, the very reluctance of the courts to even bring them to trial. 75 days. They were walking around after Arbery was slain. Had a prosecutor there who felt, well, that's just justifiable, slam dunk. And had not Arbery's mother been insistent, this trial wouldn't even be before us, period. I mean, it just wouldn't. But I think what the biggest thing to look at here now, Big Chief, is this. You know, you cannot put a complexion on evil. If you've heard nothing else on this show, you've heard that. There are individuals, I think, who, regardless of the circumstances, will not see the humanity in others. They will not see that an assailant and or a victim. Or at the very least, like in the trial of Rittenhouse, there were no victims. How could you, if there was no victim, there was no crime, bro. Was there any other way for the jury to rule? Rosenbaum and Huber and Gutscrews. I know I'm murdering his name, I'm sorry. His name is Gage. These guys were not victims. They were either considered rioters, protesters, or arsonists.
Not even the ones that were dead.
It's incredible. I mean,
he was a gunshot recipient.
For that alone, there should have been a mistrial.
Exactly.
However, the prosecutor didn't call for a mistrial.
And that's why I'm assuming that you think he might have been...
Oh, absolutely.
...in on it.
You can't do this. How are you going to have a trial, a murder trial, and there's no victims? Come on, America. Come on. And that was the main reason. My main reason was saying, oh, and this prosecutor went along with this? He went along with this? And yes, there needs to be a federal charge, and it needs to come quickly. Eric Garland, the Justice Department need to file federal civil rights violation charges against Rittenhouse. And you need to do it quickly. Need to do it quickly and get a prosecutor that is worthy of prosecuting this case. Again, how you gonna not object to a judge saying there were no, that the judge objected to the prosecutor referring to the dead as being victims?
I mean,
the two unarmed men. I mean, what do you do? And you supposed to walk away from this? Oh, yeah, I think it came out all right. I think it's
right, right, exactly. You know, and I mean, we've heard countless times folks calling to defend Kyle on this show bring up those non-victims, those gunshot recipients' criminal records, as if Kyle had pulled these guys up on the what do they call the thing where they log all your criminal...
the ICS?
Yeah, you're right. To know that, oh, okay, that guy's got a child record. That guy's also got a domestic record. These guys are ripe for the killing. Come on.
Incomprehensible. Can I go to, was it Jackal? No? Morris. Where are you? Right there. Good morning, Morris. Oh, Morris got scared. Don't get scared, Morris. It's okay.
Sorry about that.
Yeah. I think that was Jackal. We had a little phone gribbling.
Yeah. Calls back, Jack.
All right, 228-896-9455. Yes, there's other things. I need to share this with you folks, especially you folks in Mississippi. Just the everyday blue-collar guy, black, white, brown, indifferent. Listen to me. We are still in the throes of what was called Jim Crow. No, actually, it's the feudal system where you had the very rich and the very poor. Now, hang on. You may not be very poor. might be middle class, might be doing fairly well. However, you're still in that same system. What system is that? I'll tell you. The conservative concept of protecting the good old boys. There is a layer here that you and I both know that will be privy to and control things. Why, you ask? I'll tell you why. Because they're the ones, the golden rule, the one with the gold makes the rule. Now look, just by having the gold is not in and by itself a bad thing. It's not an evil. I think Gates have done a lot of stuff. I think Warren Buffett has done some things. There's no doubt that your money doesn't define you, but the problem is having the power and the money. And what you have here in this state is exactly that. You've got a governor, Dictator Reeves, a speaker, Philip Gunn, even the lieutenant governor, Deborah Holtzman. All of these individuals are getting their marching orders from some serious kingmakers right here in this state. Yeah, many of them are bankers, I don't mind telling you. Some of them are farmers, big, huge corporate farmers, and some are attorneys. And I'm talking old money here. Now, I'm not going to, this is no conspiracy. This is actuality. When you look at the fact that we're the poorest state in the union, have the least insurance, the most unhealthy, highest in hypertension and diabetes, you know, all the bad lists we're at the top of and all the good lists we're at the bottom of. We do not fund education comparable. Highest incarceration rate.
Or even fully based on the state's formula to do so, education.
You realize those stats were the same stats that existed when there was enslavement here in Mississippi. You realize that? If not, you should. Now, the very rich caused Mississippi to be in the top 18 richest when before the Civil War. No, really, the cotton was king and so forth. But the also counted in that richest was enslaved. The value of those enslaved, which Mississippi had a whole bunch. I'm telling you, of the 4 million enslaved when the war began, Mississippi had its fair share. But this is not a slavery story. This is a maintain the same system story. So when you look at us being at the top of every bad list, bottom of every good list, in 1860, it was the same in 1960, and it is the same in 2021. And the same people are controlling Mississippi then, are controlling it now. Not exactly the same people, but the same ideology. The same good old boy system that was in place then is in place now. And it is adversely affecting every Mississippian, especially those of you, black, white, brown, indifferent, who are just trying to make a day every day. I'll further explain when we come back.
Get the info. Get the info.
Stay informed. It's a new day with Rip Daniels, the number one talk show in South Mississippi on Jay-Z 94.5.
Hello?
Sweet Jesus.
What's happening, bro?
What's going on with you, bro?
Man, hey, you remember old girl from the other night?
Yeah, little sexy chick.
Yeah, from the club.
Oh, yeah.
Man, baby, wow, you heard?
No, man.
You ain't gonna believe what she did when I got to her place.
She a freak?
Man, let me tell you about it. Did you want a cold Pepsi and a hot man?
Hey.
I didn't understand a cold Pepsi and a hot man. Said you want a cold Pepsi and a hot man.
Well,
she had it in a plane. A cold Pepsi and a hot man.
Anybody have a problem with that?
No, she had it in her plans.
Just the other night.
Of course, I guess she just got a cream soda, huh?
She was looking so right.
You know. All right, good morning, folks. Rip Daniels here. Thank you for joining us. I don't know how they come up with this. Who is that, bro?
Jeter Jones.
Oh, Jeter Jones. You come up with a boy, cold Pepsi and a hot man. Yeah, that's a Monday morning thing. All right, good morning. The show is called The New Day. One rule, no such thing as a right or wrong opinion. I asked you to go to our Facebook page because we wanted to see what you thought about the Mississippi. State of Mississippi now is allowing you to put your license and your vaccination card on the phone. And the question, simple question is, would you?
The question was answered by Jerry thusly. I'm okay with it, but I asked for my ID. If asked for my ID by an officer and my battery on my phone is out, or I just lost it, or simply don't have my phone, is he going to be okay with that? That's an excellent question.
Well, I wonder whether you're still required to have one, a physical driver's license. You know, we can't be that far away from facial recognition, whereby an officer is able to put a little beam on your face and see who you are and pull up everything.
Oh yeah, I mean, I'm certain that certain federal agencies have access, if not already using that. On our chat room via our website, we're also posing these questions. If you want to go there and answer as well, you can get there through your app. Kelvin says, driver's license on my phone? I really don't have a problem with it. Having an iPhone makes me makes me feel a bit more protected concerning my identity. Does it?
Really?
Really? Wow. Okay.
He believes that encryption thing?
I mean, look, if you have anything that can receive or send a digital signal, whether it be a cell wave or what, or Bluetooth... Someone can get in that. Don't feel too safe, Kelvin. Kevin, sorry. VO says, Rip, when are we going to wake up and see that this system is rigged for white power, not right power?
You know, it's not really. You just had a case in Kenosha involving Caucasians. And look, folks, I know that they're white inferiors, no doubt about that. But never once think that applies to every Caucasian, because it doesn't. And I'm probably the only one who is seeing that. It is unfortunate, however, that you still have that silence. You know, the one that Martin Luther King talked about, you know, the silence of good folk, allow evil to thrive, those folks. You still have that, I think. I think that's one way to dilute the power of any set group, and that is participate. What we're seeing right now is almost tantamount to what we saw during Jim Crow, where African Americans were disenfranchised. Real, I am not seeing nearly enough African American jurors. So out of the jury pool that they had there in Brunswick, Georgia, out with about 1,000 jurors, you only had 9. 8 of them were struck. That jury pool is based upon the number of voters. And Brunswick now is about 50-50, maybe even majority African-American. That's just Brunswick. But in the county, it's like one quarter of the population is
African-American. Whoa. Are you blaming the lack of blacks on the McMichael Bryan jury on the lack of blacks being registered to vote in Brunswick when you heard the judge say what he said about how they chose who got to stay and who should go?
Well, there's no doubt. He said discrimination. I agree with that. I hear that, Ro. But there should have been more African-American in the jury pool.
Yeah,
it should have been. If it's one quarter of the population of that county.
There absolutely should be more black registered voters in that county. I don't dispute that whatsoever. But we can't lean on that as a reasoning for the jury looking like it looks when the judge himself acknowledged that there was discrimination in how they were picking who should stay and who should go in that particular case.
And the judge himself was elected.
Right, exactly.
So that makes my point. In other words, there's got to be a greater enthusiasm on the quote-unquote minority to vote in block.
Yeah.
I mean that, folks. Look, there's strength in numbers. And when you are a quote-unquote minority, and everybody knows, you know, who not to vote for and who to vote for, then trust me on this, it makes all the difference. That's how races will run. Now, you know, that combined with the fact, and it's not just black and white, it is about the interest and the condition. I guarantee you that an African American, I guarantee you I had more in common with Aubrey than the people who shot him. And both live there in Georgia. I guarantee you. In their eyesight, they had nothing in common with me. They certainly weren't jogging. That's for sure. 228-896-9455. Let's go to Kemp. Kemp, good morning. How are you?
Hey, good morning, Mr. Daniels. You mentioned facial recognition at airports, and just in general. I know they are using them at airports now. Mm-hmm. I was privy to it a few times in the last couple of years where I didn't have to present my boarding pass. I just basically went up and looked at my face and scanned my face and got onto the plane.
You know, I went all over Africa in 2018 with the same thing. They had facial recognition in Africa and my fingerprints. That was it. It took me from Senegal to Tanzania all the way down to South Africa. And in every airport, state of the art, facial recognition and my fingertip. I mean, and I come back to this country and we're handing out passports. Go figure.
I'm just glad that we're moving toward the rest of the world with our airports, and hopefully we're going to even move faster with the passing of this upcoming infrastructure bill. You mentioned the phone thing. That was very convenient when I was in Europe recently for a couple of months. Everywhere I went, everything was on my phone. Now, one thing that they're doing a little bit smarter to me is that they gave some of the non-vaccinated people some buy-in. In other words, if you can prove via a doctor's record that you have been infected before with COVID, that's just as good as a vaccination record. And to me, that kind of dumbed down the stupidness, if you will. That gave a quarter of the population some buy-in versus sitting at home complaining about having to get vaccinated. I think we should look into doing that also.
So how would they do that? You know, I guess the question would be, they would have had to shown some symptoms. So what they could do is those who have shown some symptoms and gone through it, I guess that'd be the way to do it. Not necessarily go to the physician, but wherever they had shown symptoms. I've never had symptoms. I don't know if you've had symptoms out there. You went through the line and they tested you. Did they give you a card to indicate that you had tested positive?
Yeah, it's basically like I said. You have to go via a doctor though. In this case, what they're doing over there is if you've been infected with COVID-19 before in the past, and you can prove it medically, you present that with your other information, just like a vaccine card. And like I said, to me. I mean, you still got your knuckleheads protesting and not wanting to wear a mask and blah, blah, blah. But they did two things that seemed like, to me, got them ahead of the curve. One, they're testing kids in school 3 times a week.
Good.
My little boy gets tested Monday, Wednesday, and Friday every week, no questions asked. And so he's allowed to go in the restaurant, movie theaters, and whatnot without any documentation. And again, the other thing was the buy-in that they gave to the people who have not been vaccinated but have been infected. Again, that puts about a quarter of the population in the fight, if you will, without having them having no say in the whole conversation. I think that's what we have here. We got a quarter of our population that have not been vaccinated, but can't prove that they've been infected also. So they don't have nothing they don't have nothing on the table, if you will.
Hey, hang on. This is interesting because I need to ask you about Holland as well. Quick break. We'll be back.
Get the info.
Stay informed. It's a new day with Rip Daniels, the number one talk show in South Mississippi on Jay-Z 94.5.
It's your one and young Weezy, man, it's too easy. Different for every season, showing me they cleavage. I take drugs and feel relaxed, it's like they're therapeutic. She take that pussy on call back so she won't think I need it.
All right, folks, good morning to you. Rip Daniels here. Thank you for joining us. The show, Carl. It's a new day. There's only one rule, no such thing as a right or wrong opinion. I know I've been tardy on my history facts. I apologize for that. For the warrior, the African-American fighting man out there, warrior, period. So I need to get caught up. It was on this date, folks, that one Oscar James Dunn, Lieutenant Governor of Louisiana, died unexpectedly. He was trying to gain control of the state government. It was 1871, of course. That's after the Civil War. It is believed that by then, Dunn fell victim to poisoning. He was succeeded by P.B.S. Pinchback. You got it. He was an African-American, no doubt, became Lieutenant Governor. He was stationed right there in the Wrigley's, right there on Highway 90. You'll see Fort Pike there. Get an opportunity. Go take a look at that because there were African-American, the U.S. colored troops stationed there. You know, with that in mind, there's another, thanks to Mun Benny McRae, who's just a living history when it comes down to the African-American fireman, especially during the Civil War. If you ever wondered how well they did and how well they fought, it was described by one Colonel T.W. Higginson. It was his compliments of one Robert Sutton of Company G. He was formerly enslaved there on the St. Mary's River. We won incredible, should I say, compliments, rightly so. But Higginson really described the African-American fighting man. No officer in this regiment, he says, now doubts that the key to successful prosecution of this war lies in the unlimited employment of black troops, he says. Their superiority lies simply in the fact that they know the country, while the white troops do not. And moreover, that they have a temperament, position, and motive which belong to them alone. Instead of leaving their homes, he says, talking about the black soldiers, instead of leaving their homes and families to fight, they are fighting for their homes and families right there in the South. And they show the resolution and the sagacity which a personal purpose gives. He goes on to compliment. It would have been madness to attempt this with the bravest white troops, what I have successfully accomplished with the black ones.
And the church said amen.
Amen to that. And that's the story that you don't hear here, especially in the South, and the one that yours truly advocates. Young African-Americans out there with a gun need to hear what to actually do with the gun and who their enemies were.
So empowering.
And once they do hear that, then trust me, hopefully they'll be the better for it and not see each other as enemies. Can I go to, I want to go back to Kemp. Kemp, you know, I've been watching what's happening in Holland now and other Scandinavian countries and even Denmark. And there's a surge of COVID. And, I mean, there's no doubt you would call the broadcast and you were very complimentary of how things were going, especially there in Germany. So yeah. What do you think is happening now? Is there a new variant going on? Because typically what happens in Europe happens here eventually.
I want to tell you, this is what I think was going on, Rip. I think there are new variants out there, but I think that the governments are not privy to allowing that to get out to the media that we have these variants. Because by saying variants, it sounds like it's never ending, and it sounds scary, you know? Mm-hmm. And if you just show numbers going back up, that looks like the people are not doing what they're supposed to be doing versus the government not doing what they should be doing.
I mean, but wouldn't you think?
I really believe that.
Can't, wouldn't you think that that would drive more people to want to take every precaution? That idea that this might not ever end. You know what I'm saying? I mean, we still have a lot of stuff that's never ending. Influenza is here to stay. So, I mean, I hear what you're saying. It just seems like it's having a different effect.
I agree. I believe COVID's here to stay. But again, there's something very funny about this situation. I went over there, man, in the beginning of September, I think it was. And let me just tell you something. The numbers were just diving down. Everything was opening back up. You know, people were out playing and festivals and music and things. Carnivals were back going on. And then all of a sudden, the numbers just start going. I mean, without no change of activity, numbers just start skyrocketing again. And now I just talked to my family today over there, and they're on the verge of locking stuff back down in Germany also.
Yeah.
And I just think that there are variants out there, but I think that they're going to go about it not being so public about, you know, naming this variant and that variant. But I really believe that we got other variants out there that are not being controlled properly.
All right. Can't appreciate it. Quickly, Jackal, sorry about that.
Don't worry about it. I was just informing Roe that the gentleman that from Racine, Wisconsin, that defended Rittenhouse is the Boyce Holloman of his area. You understand what I'm saying?
I understand.
If you want to get off of something, that's the guy you go see.
All right, Doc, good morning.
Good morning, Mr. Daniel. You know, we talked about you once were blind. I once was blind, but I can't see. Well, what you think, is any different than a prayer meeting and a square meeting?
Preachers don't go to square meetings, brother.
Really? <No. laughs> You don't know where you're going. Any road to take you there. Going 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 Going any road to take you there. Going any road to take you there. Going any road to take you there.